Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you, Mom. That was wonderful. First of all, I just want to thank everyone that you guys that came out to the meetings last weekend, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Thanks for coming and blessing Brother Todd and his family and his team that was with him. And he was really blessed, and he just loves his church. And he loves the people here. He says it's just so, I mean, so free and so open. He says it's just, he loves it. So anyways, I just want to thank you for coming and being a part of those meetings. Those meetings were so prophetic that it changed my life. I mean, I got been saved, and that changed my life. But this last weekend, just, I can't even, it would take me hours upon hours to just try to relay to you, to get you to comprehend what the prophetic word of the Lord that came through him and his ministry this last weekend did for my life personally. So anyways, I just want to thank you for coming. Amen? Amen. Lord, we thank you so much for this time of gathering today. God, I thank you for the responsibility that you've given me, not only as a pastor in this region or this city, this community, this county, but Lord God, just the responsibility you've given me to be a prophet as well and to speak what you've given me to share today. And Lord, I just, before the people today, I don't take that lightly, but I take that very serious today, Lord. And I thank you, Father God, that you just help me convey, you help me speak. Lord, let it be your oracles that come through me today and then fill the hearts of your people that are hungry and thirsty for revival, that are hungry and thirsty for the move of God, that are hungry and thirsty for a deeper relationship with you, Father. And I ask you just to speak through me today in that. And Lord, I thank you that you give us ears to hear, eyes to see, and hearts to understand, to know what is the length, height, the width, the depth of your love, your knowledge, your wisdom, your grace. And Lord, I thank you so much, Lord, that your hand is upon this. And I say no devil in hell will torment, will confuse, will come against the minds of the people of God today. And I say that this message, this prophetic, actually this prophetic word that you sent me here this morning to deliver, Lord, I thank you that it will pierce our hearts today, God. That it will grow roots. It will take hold in our spirit, Lord. And we will grow. We will grow, we'll grow, we'll grow in the anointing, the power, and the depth that you want us to go to, Father. In your love, in your word, in your power, and in your spirit today. In Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Now, you know, there's sometimes where... Excuse me, there's sometimes where, holy God, man, I'm just getting whacked. There's sometimes this morning, there's just a real heavy glory on my life today. And, you know, I lost my reputation a long time ago. I really don't care if people think about me or what they say about me or all that stuff. I'm a weirdo, that's fine. That's between me and the Lord, but I really don't care. So I'm just going to say today what the Holy Spirit wants me to say today, amen? And so, you know, so we're starting off really good now. You know, there's sometimes where I'll come here and, you know, there'll be a word to give and there'll be a message to minister or something the Holy Spirit wants to say to us today and things like that. And that's the case this morning, but today there's just a different level that's on me today. There's a prophetic mantle. The prophetic mantle's on me this morning. And it came on me last night, really, as I was spending time before the Lord and just resting in His presence. And He began to talk to me and I began to write. And actually, He began to talk to me last Sunday morning about what I'm going to preach or what I'm going to prophesy and deliver prophetically today. He began to talk to me last Sunday morning and I began to write. And last night, He added some stuff onto it last night from a word that was given in Todd's meeting. I was up in Sacramento on Thursday night where he was at. And He gave a prophetic word. And God began to expand and expound. I should say He began to expound to me on that word that was given Thursday night up at His meeting and added some stuff to it specifically for this body.
Amen.
So today, I just want you to listen, and I really want you to have ears to hear today. Don't be distracted today by what's going on. Eat chips and drink soda and watch football later or whatever, but just get that out of your mind for today. Super Bowl Sunday is like holidays to me. It's, you know, can't get distracted.
That's right.
Fine and dandy, football's fun, but just listen today. Because I really believe that this is, And when the Lord said this to me, I go, Lord, I don't want to say that. But I really believe this is one of the biggest words the Lord's ever given this body since we've been here since 1983 today.
Praise God.
They're all big, but for the time we're in right now.
Hallelujah.
I really believe that today.
Thank you.
Yeah. And so I really hope we're getting a good recording of this today on CD, because I know I'm gonna wanna have it myself, but I really believe this, and I just want to share it. So the Lord started talking to me about this body here, the Believer's Church of Madera, this ministry here. He began to talk to me last Sunday about it, and as I was spending time with him this morning, I heard the Lord say this to me today. Because I came here this morning knowing on the inside that I was going to deliver this prophetic word today to the body of Christ at Believer's Church of Madera. So I came here with that attitude, that heart attitude, that mindset. But during praise and worship, the Lord spoke to me and said, it's for the people here, but as you deliver that prophetically today, because it's a declaration is what I'm going to do today. And if you'll get in agreement with it, it'll start to affect your life, and it'll start to affect your family, and it'll start to affect the area that you're in, the region you're in. That's what the Lord said to me today. He said, it's not just for that, but it's going to go out of these walls and affect the region that we're in today as I share this today. There's angelic messengers here today to grab a hold of the word from the Lord that's going to be spoken by this vessel right here. He just uses me today to do that. Okay? He's going to use me to speak that. The messenger angels are going to write and go out and do what God tells them to do today.
Amen.
You know, getting off on that just for a second here on the angel topic, I want to share this with you. We had something really cool happen. Last year when Todd was here in February, there was a gentleman that was sitting kind of right where you ladies are sitting right here on the end of one of these rows right here. And he came up to me, and this man's reputable. I've known this man for a long time. He's a strong believer. He's not weird. And he came to me after the meeting, and he brought me two little feathers. I've never seen these kind of feathers before. They were really small. They were probably like that big. And they just had like a unique look. And he brought them and said, hey, man, after the meeting was over, I saw these on the floor. And I thought, okay, pretty cool. So I kept them, and I put them in a little envelope. And so this was last February, right? Okay, I haven't seen anything like that since, nothing like that. I clean the church. So I'm here twice a week, and I'm vacuuming in here. Last Wednesday, I'm over here and I got the big vacuum. I mean, this you put your hand in there, it might suck you up in it. That's how strong this vacuum is, man. It's one of those industrial ones. So I'm wanting, you know, I'm vacuuming. And I get right to the chair where Virginia's sitting. Verge is sitting. Sister Verge. So I'm standing there and I'm vacuuming, and I see this. This looks like a piece of tissue that's on the chair there. You know, if there's something there, I'll just put it on the chair and suck it right off, you know. So I put it on there and it didn't come off. I thought, what the heck? So I did it again. What is this thing? So I did it one more time and it didn't come off. And I thought, what in the world is this? So I reached out and I picked it up. I just pulled it right off the chair, and it was the same exact style of feather that was here last year when Todd was here. Same look. Same design, same size, same everything, and pretty much it's within a row or two of the same spot when he was here last year. And I'm like, Lord, that's awesome. And immediately I know, and some people think, oh, you're weird. Well, God gives us signs, man, for a purpose. There's angels here, there's activity here to minister.
Amen.
And I know there's messenger angels here today that are waiting. I haven't seen them. But I know they're here in my spirit.
Amen.
They're waiting to write down what's declared today.
Amen.
And as you get in agreement with that prophetic word today, they're going to go out and be about your business. What you're declaring, what you're crying out for, what you're asking the Lord for, your family, whatever it is. They're going to go. That's biblical. Amen? You can read about the messenger angels in the Bible all over the place. Amen? So it's true. So God started talking to me today, or last Sunday, about this church. And this is what he said. He said, it's time for harvest. It's time for the harvest in the Believer's Church. It's time for the people that are hooked in here. This is your local church. You've planted yourself here. You know this is it. It's time for harvest to come, not only in your personal life and in your family's life, but it's time for you to be the harvesters.
Yes. Right.
Okay? It's harvest season. There's a new, God started talking about, there's a new season. It's a new season now. We've entered into a new season here at this ministry, at this church. He began to talk to me about changes. There will be changes. And he even said this. He even said there will be people that will change.
Right. Amen.
There'll be people that will leave and there'll be people that will come. As a pastor, that's not a lot of fun to hear that, but sometimes that happens. There's been times over my lifetime since I've been around here, there's people here that I thought would never leave left. And that's not an exciting thing, but that's up to the people and God and all that kind of stuff. So I don't even get over into all that. But he says there will even be changes, even people.
Right.
And it also says God will bring people and to here, but also the people that are already here. He said he'll raise you up, and he also said there's to be a harvester. He also said there's people that are here that are already harvesters.
Right.
You're active in that call. You're active in that anointing. You're active in the body and in the army of the Lord.
Yeah.
You know, I had a lady here just last week that attends our church here. You know, she sent me a message, and she told me she was going down to pray for an elderly woman. For a situation that was going on in her body, and she just asked me that I would get in agreement with them, and asked me for some advice or some scriptures and stuff. So I just delivered what I felt like the Lord wanted me to deliver to him, and then the person got back to me later on that night and said that lady got healed, and strength began to come into her body. She was able to walk and do things she couldn't do, and she also gave her life to Jesus Christ. She was 83 years old. That's harvesting. Jesus said, I'll leave the 99 just to come to the one.
Yes.
Mine.
Just for that one. Just for that one. Amen?
Amen.
So there's harvesters that are being brought up, being raised up. Now let me say this to you. You don't have to copy or mimic somebody else.
Amen.
You do what God's called you to do. You say it how God's called you to say it. You go where God's called you to go. You don't have to be like, you know, you see a certain person on YouTube or you know, who's who in the charismatic zoo or whatever, you know, you see all this stuff going on. Don't try to be like them. Be what God's called you to be.
Amen.
Come on.
You know how to say it, how to do it, and God will move through you.
That's right. Yeah.
He's given you a personality because he's given it to you.
Yeah.
And he'll use your personality, and he'll use what he's called you to do. He'll use you mightily. Just be yourself.
That's right. He will.
Amen.
Just be yourself.
Amen.
So he says, there's harvesters that are active now, but they're being raised. Season of change is here. And this is what he ended it on when he got to talk to me last Sunday morning. This is what he left me with. He said, Believer's Church will not be a church or a ministry of loaves and fishes Christians.
That's right.
What is that? That's Christians that just want the hype. Wherever God, you know, I'm just going to go only when they're giving out food or when something spiritual is going to happen.
Yeah.
When I know that it's just something spiritual. What that is that's somebody that's going to stick faithful to. You're not a loaves and fishes Christian. You're a Christian that's sticking to God no matter what you're going through, no matter what's going on, no matter what's happening in your life.
Yeah.
You don't come just for the show.
Right.
Or for the dramatic.
Yep.
Amen.
Lord, yeah, thanks for telling me to say that. Yes. You know, Todd Bailey's here, we pack the building out.
Yeah.
But when we have prayer, there's 10 people here.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, true.
Mm-hmm. All right. So, in other words, and I understand, sometimes you can't make it. Okay? I get it. This isn't easy. That prayer is the most important thing.
Amen.
This ministry won't make it without prayer.
Right.
Your life won't make it without relationship.
Amen.
Amen. we get together here, and I know you can stay home and pray for this church, you can pray for Madera, you can pray for the ministry, you can pray for the world, you can do that. That's huge, and we should do that, and that should be the number one priority. I get it. But there's something to think about there for a second. You're not too busy. I mean, you can find time to come to a corporate prayer meeting. Okay. It's big. It's changed my life.
Yeah.
Yeah. It has. Now, of course, I know, see, and we hear this a lot, you know. Well, you're a pastor, so, you know, that's what you get paid to do. Believe me, I'll go find a job that pays more if that's what I'm really into it for. You know what I mean? Because I know I can do that. That's your job, you know. That's you live at the church and you're always there and all this, and that's true. But there's times where the Holy Spirit's nudging some of you.
Right.
You need to be here on a Tuesday morning, or you need to be here on a Wednesday night.
Come on.
And gather with the corporate body. Gather with the ones that are here that are pressing in. And we do pretty decent for a Wednesday night. We usually have around 10 to 15 people come out on Wednesday night for corporate prayer and all that. And we have about the same, maybe, you know, right around there on Tuesday morning and stuff and all that. And it's good. We have two times we open it up. Also an hour before service. That's big too. But listen, prayer is the key, man.
Yes.
And I'm not going to get over into that, but I'm just saying, let that speak to you this morning. Don't, you know, if you get angry at me for saying that, I'm sorry. Just, you know, get over and forgive me, because you have to. But we're not that busy that we can ditch certain things. I mean, an hour out of the week. We're usually here an hour and a half on Wednesday night. We come in, we share a little bit, and we dig into prayer, and it's great, man, and it's changing things. A lot of this stuff I'm going to prophesy and deliver to you today is because of corporate prayer.
Yep.
What has taken place in our corporate prayer meetings the last 4 or 5 years.
Amen.
It's come to a head finally in some areas. So, amen. So, we won't be loaves and fish as Christians. We're going to be people that are pressing in and that want all that God has. We're going to be out moving and shaking. There's going to be some things happen here in the future in this ministry, that there's going to be some things that are going to open up to where it's not going to just be, you know, just prayer and services. We're going to have like healing things. We're going to have like maybe even like discipleship type school stuff. There's going to be stuff, training things are going to start taking place. There's wells that are being opened.
Yeah,
things are starting to happen.
Yeah.
Okay, so that gets me over to this portion of it. Okay, so I'm up there Thursday night, and Tom Billing gets up and he gives his prophetic word. And as he's giving this prophetic word, I write as fast as I can write. I didn't get all of it, but I know I got the pieces of it that God wanted me to get of it. Amen. And as I was just meditating on that word, the Lord started speaking to me last night about some stuff and took me over to some scriptures. And he really made some stuff very, very plain to me concerning you guys and this ministry and this area and this region and this territory here in the valley, the Central Valley that we're in. And this is what the word said. It said that God is getting ready to pour out, and there's wells that are being broken up in hidden places. There's hidden churches. Listen, I'm telling you right now, we've kind of been a hidden church over the past 33 years. Dad's not a well-known pastor. I'm not a well-known pastor. We don't try to go out and speak at places and pump books. You know why? Because we've never written a book. We've never put out CD series. We've never done any of this kind of stuff because God never told us to do that.
That's right.
He might, but he hasn't yet. That's fine. But we've been kind of this hidden gem here.
Come on, man.
And I used to ask God, why? I mean, come on, God. This place is hopping. This place is growing. The gifts flow here. People get miracles. People get healed. The gifts of the Spirit flow. There's things that happen. We see things all the time, God. Why is it just, you know, and he says, because it's not that season or that time for the explosion yet. He's bringing, see, listen, pastor in a church, you find out, being around a pastor my whole life, you find out that, look, That God will come to a point where He'll bring a group of people together. And sometimes it might take 30 years. Sometimes it might take another 5 years from now. I don't know. But I don't think it is. I see God developing a core of people here in this ministry for expansion and for explosion. And so we've been kind of hidden here. Little bits and pieces have gone out about us, and little things, you know. We have people from those states call, can you pray? Because we know things happen when you pray, for your church prays, and all that cool stuff. It's awesome, praise the Lord. But listen, we've been kind of hidden. But God started saying that there's wells that are going to start opening up in hidden churches and unlikely cities.
Amen.
Madera, in the world's eye, is an unlikely city that God would open up a well and spring forth and move in.
Amen.
To the world's eye.
Yeah.
It is.
Amen.
I hear more people talk junk about Madera than they talk good about Madera.
Yeah. True.
This is my promised land. It's a blessed land.
Right.
And there's fruit here. Not just natural fruit, there's spiritual fruit here that I can pick from and eat.
Right.
And we can give.
Yeah.
So, hidden churches, unlikely cities, God is getting ready to pour out His Spirit on us in a greater measure. Wells are being uncovered. We have been asking, now it's time to declare it. Now, this is the word the Lord gave me. We've been asking, now it's time to declare it and expect it, believers' church.
Yeah.
Hidden wells are being uncovered. Deserts will turn into rivers.
Right.
Now turn over to Genesis chapter 26. Genesis chapter 26. This is a story about Isaac going back to redig the wells that his father left him as an inheritance, and his father left him. He would go back to redig those things. And earlier in the chapter there, in chapter 26, he's going out, and everywhere he goes, he sees that the wells are stopped up with trash or with dirt or with earth because the Philistines filled them in. The enemy filled them in. So he had to redig those things. Him and his men had to redig. Now we get down here into verse 22. Verse 22 says, and he moved. Now, let me just say this about these two verses above it here. He would go to these different wells, and they would get them going, but then they would start fighting amongst each other. The men would start fighting amongst each other. Well, this is our well. No, we're going to call it this. No, we're going to call it that. So Isaac just decided, forget this, let's move on. So he finally gets down here to chapter or verse 22, and he says, and Isaac moved from there and dug another well, and they did not quarrel over it. So he called its name Rehoboth, because he said, for now the Lord has made room for us, and we shall be fruitful in the land. That name Rehoboth, I hope I'm pronouncing it right, but that's what it looks like. That's how I've heard it pronounced. It means spaciousness or room. And God started talking to me last night about that verse there, about, look, we've come to a place here in Madera where we've opened up a well here because we've pressed in as the body of Christ. There's other believers in this city that are pressing in. It's not just us. There's other folks that are getting with the program, praise God. And they know that it's such a time as this that God wants to pour out. So it's not just us, but I can only speak for us personally. We've been digging and digging and digging and digging. And I honestly joined the digging probably about 1995. When I really started getting involved in this city and really starting to grow up and understand that there's something epic that needs to happen in Madera, California. When I was a child, I would think about this all the time. Why am I not seeing what I hear read in the book of Acts?
Amen.
I would think about that constantly. I love God, but why am I not seeing cripples walk? Why am I not seeing all this wild stuff happen? God was preparing me as a child for later on in life because that was going to be my ministry.
Yeah.
What is He even preparing you for?
Yeah.
What do you think about constantly?
Yeah.
What do you desire to do? What's your dream? What's your vision? What's God put in your heart?
Yep.
Is it evangelism? Is it going out and being a harvester? Is it just loving people and loving them? Loving them, loving them, loving them to death, to where the devil dies in them and they get life?
Yeah.
Love covers a multitude of sins.
Amen.
So he began to talk to me. You guys have been digging. Believers Church, you've been digging. You've been digging, you've been digging. People have been faithful, you've been praying, you've been digging. You've been digging the well. And he said last night that you've come to that place, Rehobo, where it's space. He's giving you space. And this is what he said to me. This is another definition for that word there, is room. He's given us room.
Yes.
He's made room for us now. That well has been dug, and there's been space made by him. There's been space made. There's been room. He's given us room for us to harvest.
Thank you, Lord. Yes.
Father.
So, it says in 23, well, I love that latter part there of 22 where it says, God made room for us, and we shall be fruitful in the land. Then, verse 23, then he went up from there to Beersheba. And the Lord appeared to him the same night and said, I am the God of your father Abraham. Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bless you and multiply your descendants for my servant Abraham's sake. Beersheba. Now let me tell you a little story about that word there. What that is a town known for its well. There's a well there that runs rich. Okay? It's still there. They still talk about it. It's still around. All that. One night about probably 7 or 8 years ago, I was here on a corporate prayer night on a Friday night. We used to have corporate prayer on Friday nights. I was here. I was sitting right over here. And we were praying. And I was praying in the Holy Ghost. And just a fervent prayer come on me. Just the power of God was on me. And I was just praying. I was praying. And all of a sudden I started saying, I probably said it about 20, 25 times in the Spirit. Beersheba, 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 Beersheba. I just started saying it. I had no idea what it was, but I knew I had heard it before. So I got immediately in the, this is back before I had the Bible app on my phone. So I went to the old school concordance. Found out where it's at. What is it? Found in the Bible. Found out that it's a place. It's a town known for its well. And the Lord was showing me that night. Look, this Madera is going to be known for a place of the well, of the living water. See, so God, you can kind of see what's going on here. God's putting this. This was 7 or 8 years ago. God's putting this together for me right now, personally. That this is a place like Beersheba. Where the well of the Lord is going to flow richly. What does it say in John 7:38? It says, out of your belly will flow rivers of living water.
Right.
Out of your belly. You've got to picture that for a second. Picture the river of God just gushing out of your innermost being. Gushing out into people's lives, guys. Know who you are. Listen, don't be stingy with the anointing. Give it out.
Come on.
Yeah.
Don't be afraid to give it away. The Holy Ghost is a feeling sometimes. Actually, you heard Todd talk about that a little bit. He gets in there and he gets in, he presses in because he wants to feel the presence of God. Nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with wanting to be close to your dad, is it?
No.
Your father? So, this goes just, listen. Yeah. This goes just deeper. We got to get out of the mindset, body of Christ, that we're just a Christian and we go to church because we want to be good.
Right. Self-righteous.
Forget that. We have a relationship with the Father because we're holy, like He is.
Yeah.
He called us holy. He's called us righteous.
Right.
We're right standing with Him.
Yeah.
Even when we fall and skin our nose, we're still right standing with the Father.
Right. Amen.
And you're anointed, and you're loved, and you're full of rivers, and you're full of life. And no matter what the devil tries to do, and tries to say, it doesn't matter how long you're in the wilderness. It doesn't matter if you feel like you're in a dry spot. You keep your eyes on the Father and you keep walking and going with Him.
Amen. Father.
And you'll find yourself when you feel like that river was just trickling.
Right.
All of a sudden it'll be a gusher.
Yeah.
Amen.
riding the rapids, baby.
Come on.
Yes. Guys, this word is as real as the name on my birth certificate today. We've got to see ourselves as a river. We've got to see ourselves as rivers of living water flowing out of us.
Yes.
We've got to see ourselves worshiping the Lord, living in that well, living in the spring, that water that's springing out of that well. We've got to see ourselves, guys, living in that. That's who we are. Listen, we're not good because we feel good. We're blessed because we have a Father that owns everything. And we're His heir. We're adopted into the beloved.
Come on.
Praise God. Let me get a drink of this holy water here. This is called watering the word.
Amen?
Old preacher jokes, man. Grew up here in them all my life. Madera is a town, is going to be a town known for the glory well of God.
Amen.
I said, God, what is this town last night? And this is exactly what he said, and I wrote it down. It's my glory well.
Hallelujah, Lord.
Yeah. Let that whack you right across the forehead. It's God's glory well. Well, prove it, Pastor. Don't have to. Tell God to prove it. He'll prove it. Nothing I can do about it, but just flow in that glory. Just like you.
Amen.
Come on.
I've had nothing but word after word after word by prophet, by minister, by some of you, that God, you know, the glory of God's going to hit Madera. The glory of God's going to be so thick that people are going to see that fog. They're going to see it. It's going to look like fog, but it's going to be the glory. It's going to be the smoke that filled the temple. Praise God. It's going to be the glory of God. It's going to be a transforming power that none of us, I believe, have ever even seen, felt, or even understood before. That's what's coming to this town.
Exactly.
If God can take Evan Roberts into Wales, why can't he take you into Madera? Why can't he take you into Madera County, praise God? Why can't he take you, some of you are from Fresno, why can't he take you into Fresno?
Amen.
And be that Evan Roberts.
Amen.
Why can't you be that Charles Finney? You walk in a room, people just begin to weep and cry and give their life to Christ. Why not?
Yeah.
Oh, man. That was Charles Finney. You know what Charles Finney did? He spent time with his Father. That's all he did.
Amen.
He was an educator and he prayed.
Right.
That's what the guy did.
Amen.
He had a secular job and he prayed. Right. And God used him.
Amen.
Still have a school going there in New Jersey. Yes.
Wow.
He started.
Hallelujah.
They said that New Jersey back then, that whole area, I forget the I think it was Hoboken or something like that.
Hoboken.
The town, I think. There was a revival going on there when he was there. The whole town got saved.
Within
like a month or something like that.
Wow.
Wales, everything shut down because of the move of God.
That's right.
Yeah. And that dude, I've read his book. He wouldn't even get up and really even say anything. He would just spend time with the Father, walk into a meeting, and the conviction of the Lord would hit people, and people would get their lives to Christ.
Amen.
But I read time after time after time again how he got that. And you know how he got it? In the woods. Oh, that hits me right here. God just talking to me about me personally. We're not too busy.
Amen. Amen.
We need to drop some stuff.
Amen.
If we want to see, that happen in our city, in our state, in our region, let me say it this way. If we want to see it where we influence,
yes.
Wherever you influence, where you influence, where are you at?
Right.
If you want to see that,
yes.
It's time to get on our knees.
Amen.
Yes. Amen.
The devil wants you to run around, because he does it to me too, he tries to do it to me. He wants you to run around, get focused on what's coming ahead, get focused on what's in the past, get focused on what you got to do, and worry and fret and wonder and how and why and what if and blah, 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 blah. Have you ever heard of the devil? Slow down, Clarence.
Yeah.
Go ahead, go to your room, lay down on your bed, take about a half hour and just focus on the Father.
Yeah. Never heard him say that.
Right.
It says everything else, though.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to take this time here. Lay down. Oh, Holy Spirit, just come. I love you.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Yeah.
You have that choice.
Yeah.
I pick my phone. Oh, Starbucks. Heck yeah, man! Let's be real.
Come on.
Some of you have been upset with me lately because I haven't been answering my phone or my texts when you do it. And it's not because I don't like it, it's because you're interrupting right in the middle of what I'm doing.
Amen.
And I'll respond when I'm finished.
Amen.
I've had to make myself do that.
Yes.
Guys, I'm telling you, and I know I'm not the only one. Believe me, I seem to know that.
Yeah.
I know I'm not the only one in here today.
Hallelujah.
It's pressing. I know it. So what I'm relaying to you today is, look, we are in a place like Isaac was, that Rehoboth. We're there in that place, that open well, where God has made room for us. He's made space for us. What he's wanting to do is he's wanting us to, just like he told me here last year, take ground and occupy. He's spreading the tent stakes out. He's making room. We're spreading our, we're making room. Our territory is expanding, guys.
Hallelujah.
And if it's 10 of us, it's 10 of us. If it's 8,000 of us, it's 8,000 of us. Whatever. I just want to be a part of that remnant in Madera, California, where the glory of God, the glory wells, get ready to bust wide open. It's flowing now, but not to the magnitude that it's going to be.
That's right.
But you've got to believe that. You've got to get a hold of that. You've got to be the one that presses in regardless of what's going on, how busy you think you are. You've got to take time to hear the Holy Spirit. Because, guys, we are in a time. This is what the Lord said. Out of your bellies will flow rivers of living water. Madera will be known. I'm sorry. Anybody got a little cough or something? Yeah, I got this little tickle. You ever had that tickle?
Yes.
It's from the devil. Amen.
Yes.
Cast it out. Get out, tickle. Oh, Jesus. Shut up, tickle. Come on, Herman.
Say no.
Say no. Said, out of our rivers will flow rivers of, out of our belly will flow rivers of living water. I said, Madera will be known for its well of God's glory. Out of that well will flow. Now listen to what the Lord started telling me right now. This is, he started speaking to me this. He started just telling me word after word. I started writing last night. Out of that well will flow this. I'll read it so you can write it. Harvest and souls. Healing, deliverance, prosperity, and finances. Not just prosperity finances, but prosperity in everything of your life.
Right.
So prosper.
That's right. Amen.
In everything. You know, let me say this. Some of you are going to change jobs.
Yeah.
Get ready for it.
Yep.
It ain't going to be of the devil. Don't let them lie to you and confuse you.
Right.
Come on.
Don't get in fear and not leave that job because you think, you know, God's going to start talking to some of you about that. He's going to shift you into something different.
Amen. Thank you,
Lord. So be awake and be ready to hear that word. Prosperity of finances. Restoration of families.
Come on.
Those are all good, but here's the best. He saved the best for last. And a deeper revelation of spiritual things or of the Spirit. A deeper revelation of spiritual things or of the Spirit. A deeper revelation of the things of the Spirit. That's what's going to flow out of this well. Those things He gave that to me last night. He spoke to me those words. He gave those things. That's what's going to flow out of it. Now, here's the deal. I've decreed that today.
Right.
Because He told me to.
I agree.
And if you grab a hold of that decree and you grab it.
Amen.
And you exercise that. You put it forth by faith. You stand in agreement with that word from the Lord. Just watch, guys. Look, we don't have a long time to mess around. Sudden things are taking place. Sudden things are taking place. Todd gets here and says, I had a dream. I saw the sword of the Lord, and I saw it coming down and cutting off habits and bondages and all this junk in our families. Maybe our kids or our grandkids or our uncles, aunts, parents, whatever, are dealing with their lives, and I saw the sword of the Lord come down. And delivered. We can reject that or we can grab that. I chose to grab it. I sat over there and was calling out names that aren't even in my family. Blood family. Standing. Saying, you're coming back, man. Prodigal, you're coming back. You will go on your knees and you will serve the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory. And that 559 deal, that's
come
the
on.
Battle that he had.
Yes.
559. He didn't even know what 559 was. He found out that it covers four counties here. What is it? Madera, Kings, Fresno, Tulare?
Tulare. Wow.
That 559.
Four is the number of light, too.
Of light? Yeah. And that, yeah. No, but listen, this, I'll add on to that. The number four. This is something that's been happening to me personally. And see, I don't get up here and share everything with you guys. Just like so you don't share everything with me either. See, I've been pressing in. I think we've always been spiritual. We're spiritual people. Once we give our life to Christ, we become filled with the Holy Spirit, and He comes and lives in us, and this and that. So we become spiritual, and God starts immediately talking to us and wanting us to grow up in those things, right? But the last 3 months, I've had this happen to me twice, where I've woke up in the middle. Let me go back actually. Within the last 6 months, this has happened to me twice. I've woke up in the middle of the night. Because I've heard somebody say my name and it sounded the exact same both times and it was like this. Michael. That kind of stuff never happens to me. I'm not really a dreamer. I don't have a lot of dreams. Once I roll over on my left side, it's sawn logs until about 6 in the morning. I hardly ever wake up in the middle of the night, get up. Once I'm out, I'm out. I'll film, Monica's knee in my back every once in a while because I'm snoring or something. But other than that, I wake up, that's usually why. But I've heard that twice in the last 6 months. I've heard that. It's woken me up out of a dead sleep where I sat up and I'm looking around. First, I thought it was Monica because she calls me Michael. I'm like, what? And she's, you know, don't tell me I said that. But anyways, you know what's on the internet and on CD now, so forget it on the phone, so forget it. But I've heard that, and I'm like, all right, Lord. But the second time, it was like I knew it was an angel. I couldn't see it, didn't feel it, nothing. I just heard it. So immediately, I sit up, and I'm like, I get out of bed, and I go into the living room, and I'm like, Lord, hey, Lord, I know this is you. I know this is angelic. Are you wanting to say something to me? I'm here. I waited for about 10, 15 minutes. Nothing. So I went back to bed. So, of course, I'm talking to Dad. I'm like, man, this is what's going on. This is wild. You know, and Dad's like, well, just start asking the Lord what it is. Maybe it's something He wants to show me in the future or whatever. So the last 3 months, within the last, actually, 2 months, really, I've woken up twice in the middle of the night and I believe there sometimes there's things that have to do with numbers.
Yes.
Oh yeah.
Okay. I'm not talking about what is it, numerology and study and all this demonic junk. I'm talking about God will use numbers. It's plain. You can look in the Bible. He uses the seventh day and blah, 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 and all this. Years, numbers, all this. The mean stuff. Well, two times in the last 2 months, I've woken up and I rolled over and looked at the clock next to my bed, and it's been 4:44 a.m.
Yes.
Twice. What are the odds of that? I didn't set my alarm for 4:44. There ain't no way in God's green earth I'm going to get up at 4:44 unless I have to. And I haven't had to. So I've rolled over twice, and I've looked, and it's 4:44. So I've been asking the Lord, what is it, Lord? What does this mean? It's something. And I've been coming across those numbers, 44 and all this stuff lately, it seems like, on different things. And so I've been asking the Lord about it. So Pat Upton calls me here about 2 weeks ago, and he says, hey, I remember you sharing that with me the other day. I found something here that I think you might want to look at concerning that 444. I said, okay. So he showed me where to look at, and I watched it on YouTube, and it was about angels. And so I'm like, okay, but see, I wasn't sure. So I didn't dig in too deep, because you just never, some of that stuff out there is wacko, man, you know?
Yeah.
And I want to guard myself. I don't want to get off into something goofy, and I'll always talk to Dad about stuff, and I'll ask the Holy Spirit to show me and things like that. So I just listened to this guy a little bit, and I just kind of left it alone. I said, okay, Lord, well, you know, I'm not feeling this right now, so I just want you to make it plain to me what this is, Lord, and I'll wait for it. So Thursday night, I'm up at Bentley's meeting in Sacramento. And he's preaching, and all of a sudden he goes, it was funny, he goes, some of you in here, he goes, you've been seeing 444.
Yeah.
And I'm like, boom, my ears perk up even more, you know? They already stick out, but they stuck out even more. And I'm like, oh, what is it? And he goes, that number used to appear to me a lot too. And he goes, I found out that what it is, it means angelic activity.
Yeah. Wow.
And I'm like, okay, I was kind of hitting on that a little bit, Lord. So, okay, thanks for that. And then he said, also you can see it in Ezekiel 44:4.
Wow.
Wow. So I'm like, okay. So I turned over to that scripture, and basically the whole scripture was that the glory of the Lord and the priests filled the house. As soon as I read that, I knew why God was showing me that, because that's my call. That's on my life, is to bring the glory.
Amen.
To hook up with others, you can start sensing the glory right now. You can start talking about it. The presence of the Lord. Sometimes it's really heavy, sometimes it's just here. Like a mist or a cloud or smoke or fog. You might see it, you might not see it. But you sense that presence.
Amen.
So see, he'll start to talk to you and show you things. Be aware, be open to him. Some of you guys right now, I know it by the look on some of your faces. You're sitting there going, God, this has been happening to me. But I can't figure it out. And you know what? You won't be able to figure it out. I couldn't either. It had to be a God moment.
Yep.
He had to use somebody or bring someone across to speak to me and show me what it was. Ooh, the glory. Thank you for the glory. Man, the glory of the Lord filled the house. Ezekiel 44:4. Mom said that. I didn't. What'd you say? Four angels?
No, the four is light.
Light.
It's a number for light, illumination.
Angels, what do they bring? Illumination.
Amen.
They bring the light from the throne.
Yes.
Almost everybody I've talked to, they've seen angels, it's been bright.
Yeah.
It's been a bright light.
Yes.
He had that word 559. That God was going to bring that sword into 559 and cut off.
Amen.
The devil's throne. And check this out. We've been talking about Cyrus. I got this from Dad, so this isn't my deal. This is Dad's. We've been talking about Cyrus, King Cyrus. How a lot of folks and a lot of the prophets have spoken. He's even shown Dad and even shown me in some areas, and some of you that I've talked to about our presidency and King Cyrus. That God would bring a king in, or you know, a man in to do His will, His work, and to do it. And some of it ain't going to be easy. It's going to be hard and tough sometimes and all that, but God was going to come in and do it. Well, Dad got to researching King Cyrus, and he found out that when King Cyrus started his reign on his throne, started to be the king, was in the year 559 B.C.
When he made the decree.
Wow. Some of you, oh, wow, well, big deal. Well, I don't know. When Dad showed that to me and slapped me right across the face and just gave me more assurance that God's getting ready to blow up 559.
Come on.
Amen. We've been decreeing the 559. We've been decreeing in the 559.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
A lot of us, I can't say all of us, I don't know, but a lot of us have been decreeing in the 559.
Come on. And
what we want to see, what we want God to do, what we want to do for the Lord, what we want to be a part of in the 559.
Amen.
There's been prophecies come from Bakersfield over the years that God was going to start fires all along and up Highway 99.
Yes.
Just that's the truth. And the awesome thing is you have a ministry. You've been set apart by God, like Jeremiah, in your mother's womb. You have a part. You carry the fire. You carry the glory. You carry love. You carry the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Don't be stingy with it. Let it out. Let it flow. If you find yourself in a staff meeting at work, and all of a sudden the Holy Spirit's talking to you, and He wants you to declare something under your breath about those people or about something the devil's trying to do, you sit there and you declare that word, whatever it is. You sound the decree. The Bible says that if you'll agree with God and you'll decree what He tells you to decree, it'll be established. Yeah. You might not see the outcome of it right off the bat. It might take years, but you'll see that word come to pass.
Amen.
And it will be established.
Yeah.
Come on.
God started talking to Dad about this ministry, this church, 30-something years ago. And he's just now, right now, starting to see some of that come to pass.
Yes.
It was 33 years ago.
No.
Some of the stuff that's happening, I'm sitting back and I know. I'm watching. I'm praying. I'm listening. And I'm seeing things start to take place in some of y'all's lives. And it's like I said just a minute ago, prophetically I said it. I didn't plan on saying it. You can look at my notes. I don't even have it written down. But some of you are getting ready to change occupations.
Come on.
Some of you will no longer be in the secular job any longer. God is going to finance you to do what He's called you to do.
Yeah.
Come on! Yeah. Some will believe it, some won't believe that. God owns everything. If He wants to take you out of your what $90,000 job a year, and your 401k and all your benefits, and He wants to take that from you, let Him. Because what He's going to do for you blows that mess out of the water. Well, I won't have health insurance. What do you mean? 1 Peter 2:24. Well, yeah, but we should go to the doctor. We should go to the doctor sometimes. We need to go to the doctor sometimes. But you know what? I guarantee you there's someone on this earth that's got enough money to pay for your visit if you need to. Pastor, you're mean. No, live by faith.
God arrived.
You know, listen, health insurance is good. I have health insurance. I'm glad I do. It helps me. I'd still be paying for the cancer I went through in 2008 if I didn't.
Come on.
That's right.
But guys, there's no such thing as the American dream. It's the God dream.
Exactly.
God reminds me of that weekly. It's my dream, Mike. Not the stuff and all this. It's my dream.
Amen.
This, you guys, we are in this together. We are going to be people together that are going to put our buckets down by that well and dip.
Yes.
And pour.
Yes.
On others.
Yes,
the river of life.
Yes, amen.
The washing, the forgiveness, the blood.
Amen.
That's us.
Yes. Glory to God.
Out of that well will flow harvest, healing, deliverance, prosperity. Spirit, soul, and body is what you're going to prosper in.
Amen.
Finances, restoration of families.
Yes.
And a deeper revelation of spiritual things.
Yes. Amen.
I want to abide in all those.
Yes.
Amen.
So listen. This church has shifted gears over into a harvest.
Yes, exactly.
Yes, it has.
I've been hearing this word. I even prophesied over a couple people here in the last few weeks, where it's just come out of me. I'd never get up there to do that, but it just came out of me about some. You're going to reap your inheritance.
Come on.
Yeah. There's inheritance is coming.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah. Since some of you guys have been waiting.
Amen.
Come on.
There's restoration that is going to come to some of us with our family members, our brothers, our sisters, and our families.
Father.
Because it's that season of harvest.
Yes. Amen.
It's time to start reaping what we've been sowing.
Yes. Yes.
Now, wait a minute. I just heard some of you right now on the inside say, well, I've been sowing bad. The blood of Jesus is strong enough, I promise. If you repent, God throws it in the sea of forgiveness.
Yes,
go on.
No fishing.
Right. You've given your life to Christ. You've sowed into the kingdom by giving your life.
Yeah.
Keep growing. Keep growing. Keep growing. Keep growing.
Yes.
We're entering into harvest. We're going to start reaping.
Yes.
What the devil's trying to take from us, guys. Or what he's even stole from us, maybe some of us.
Already.
Yep.
It's coming back.
Yes.
Yep.
It's coming back to do the work of the ministry.
Yes.
It's coming back to be a blessing to your children and their children's children's
children. Yes. Amen.
You're leaving to them a heritage.
Amen.
A godly heritage. You're leaving to the next generation.
Yes.
I'm leaving that heritage. My dad's leaving it. My grandfather left that heritage to my dad. My dad left that heritage to me. I'm leaving it to my children, and my children will leave it to their children.
Amen.
And so on.
Yes.
So I pray today that you grab a hold of this. Some of you might need to watch it on YouTube again. Some of you might need to get the CD to play it over and over again to keep it in you. Because listen, when there's a prophet, I knew that there was going to be a prophetic mantle on me today to give this today. And there has been.
Yes.
And in my mind, I wish there was more people here to hear this, because it's so profound for us right now. But I just pray that some way they'll be able to hear it, or God will speak that to them or something, I don't know. But he wanted me to declare this today to you guys, and he also said it was going to go out in this region.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because folks, I'm telling you, what was prophesied here, I've heard some of you talk about already, and I've heard a lot of other people that are in the body of Christ talk about lately.
Yep.
About the wells being opened up.
Yes.
Open them.
Yep.
Amen.
There's a lot of harvesters in here.
Amen.
Amen.
It's time to harvest.
Yes. Yeah.
Sometimes it'll be downright dirty, man.
Amen.
You might have to sit in a bed of someone that's dying of cancer for 8 hours or even overnight until you see them healed. I believe that's coming back.
Come on.
You might have to go out of your way and drive 3 hours to deliver a word, or to deliver something to somebody, to harvest.
Amen.
But it's harvest time.
Yes.
I didn't want to go to Sacramento on Thursday. I didn't want to drive up there. I didn't. I would rather stay here. I had things to do here on Thursday with the church, and I had to cancel on CJ and just stuff like that. But when the Lord tells you to do something, we got to do it. And I know why he told me to do it, because I had some things come to me up there. There's other stuff I didn't share.
Yeah.
I had some things come to me up there that just absolutely revolutionized my life.
Come on.
I called Dad the next morning and just talked his head off. You know what the Lord showed me. How many of y'all have ever done that before, you know?
Yeah.
That's okay, he likes it.
Okay.
Yeah.